Colin lost his son Tim in 1993 in an IRA attack. And Colin, you are an extraordinary inspiration to any parent watching this tonight, because what you have done, you and your wife, is to really sort of re-channel that anger into something very positive.
Yes, although I would correct you, there was never any anger, interestingly. I won't get into that. That wasn't the point of your question. But no, we channeled our energies into doing something meaningful in terms of keeping Tim's name alive in the only way we could, and Jonathan, the other little boy who died. So we began with a three-way exchange program between Belfast, Dublin and Warrington for young people. And 2 years on, having seen the terrific results that that produced, we then decided we wanted to scale up. And the only way we could do that was to build our own premises in Warrington. So over the next couple of years, I fundraised with the help of one or two significant political allies, and we built the Peace Centre in 2000, and the Peace Centre is where we do most of our work.
And when you saw what happened here last night, I'm wondering if that took you right back to square one.
More than any other terrorist outrage in the years that followed Warrington, this hit me and my wife and my daughter as well. She was very upset today, because it was children, and it was children doing something perfectly normal for children, just having fun. And, you know, 20...
You said Tim was on his way just to buy, what, football shorts?
Yes, he was. Yes, he was. That's all he was doing, buying some football shorts, because he'd saved a penalty the week before for the school team. And, you know, he went out and never came home. And 22 people have done the same here, and many of them are children. And it's horrifying that such young lives can be lost like that. I was looking at some of the photographs on the news earlier, and the eight-year-old girl, what a beautiful little girl she was, and how her parents are feeling now. Well, I can imagine how they're feeling, but
What would you, I don't know if you are reaching out to them, or if you're, what would you say to them, or to anyone going through that now?
I don't know that anything could be said right now that would make a jot of difference, because they'll be so broken and so heartbroken, devastated, that I think they'd probably be deaf to most things. I found in those early days and weeks, we simply operated on a very basic level. We slept and we ate, slept and we ate. People came in and did the basic things for us, family and friends, and we were relieved of having to do anything apart from just basic existence, because the grief is so enormous. I don't think any function above the most basic is within your capabilities. And it takes time to reach the point where maybe you can start to have conversations with people whose advice may be helpful. And so I think when we might reach out to people and possibly be of help is once they've gone through that awful initial grief. Now, that might be weeks, it might be months, but whenever they're ready, we would be the ideal organisation to come and talk to, because we're a victim-founded organisation. We're not just professionals. My wife and I are still at the heart of what we do, and we can empathise in ways perhaps a professional can't.
Colin, thank you very much indeed.